A declaration, as we normally do on a Sunday service, and when we gather together, I just want to remind us of why we do our declaration. You know, God has done something amazing. In Ephesians chapter 1, it tells us that, you know, God has raised Jesus up and he has put all things under his feet and made him the head of the church. So everything is under the feet of Jesus, and Jesus is head over everything, and he's put everything under his feet, and he said the church is his body. You know, if the church is his body and everything is under his feet, then everything is actually under the church, under the feet of Jesus. We are his body. Therefore, everything is under our feet. So we as a church, and I say church, I'm talking about believers all over the world, that together we have authority, we have dominion, even over COVID-19 and what it's doing in the nations. We, the church, have authority. So we are going to dominate it. We are going to tell it that it cannot progress in the nations. It has to recede. We want to break the power of that and its effect over the nations. We have the authority to do it because according to the word of God, everything is under his feet and we are his body. That means everything is under our feet as well. Now, as believers, the reason we declare the word of God is because in Ephesians 6 verse 19, as Paul is talking to us about the armor of God, verse 17, he says, Ephesians 6:17, he says, take the helmet of salvation and the sword of the Spirit, which is the word of God. So you and I have a weapon in our hands. It's the sword. It's an offensive weapon against the enemy. It is the word of God. And what do you do with the word of God? Of course, you have to believe the word, but we also have to speak the word. The spoken word is like a sword that's released against the enemy. And the Holy Spirit goes, accompanies that spoken word. That's why we encourage people to speak the word. Say what God has said about you. Declare it with your mouth. And when you and I do it, it's a weapon against the enemy. It's an offensive weapon that attacks the enemy. So are we going to stand to our feet and make our declaration? Now, depends on where you're watching. If you're in your home, your living room or somewhere, and you're able to stand, I encourage you to stand as we make this declaration. But if you're in some place where you cannot stand, you have to sit, that's perfectly fine. Just hold your Bible and we will make our declaration like we do every Sunday when we gather together. So let's say our declaration together. This is God's word. This is God speaking to me. I am who God says I am. I can do what God says I can do. I will become everything God has promised. I'm saved, healed, delivered, redeemed. I am blessed, victorious, prosperous, triumphant. I'm a minister of God, a servant of Christ, and a channel of his blessing. To many people, I receive his word, I believe his word, and I live by his word. Christ is my master, and to him I am in absolute surrender. I receive new wine and fresh oil being poured out on me. God releases new things and a new work of his Spirit in me and through me, in Jesus' name, amen. God bless you. You may be seated. I know I made a little mistake in the declaration, but that's okay. I trust that as we spend time in God's word, you will be encouraged. You know, in our normal Sunday service, this Sunday would have been a supernatural Sunday, what we call as a supernatural Sunday. What the message that we preach is a very, very simple message that is geared towards building faith in the hearts of people in order to receive healing, miracles, and deliverances. And that's exactly what we're going to do on this service today that comes to you through digital media. Now, You know, we have been doing a series on being a disciple of Jesus. So we've covered two messages on that, and they're available on the YouTube channel where you're watching probably, or through our church website. They're all available. So you can, in case you missed those two, you can go back and listen to them. We will continue that next Sunday. So please make sure you tune in to the live stream next Sunday as we continue talking about a disciple of Jesus Christ. But on the service today, we are going to talk about God's touch. Just one touch is what I'm calling this message. Just one touch. You know, when the Lord Jesus walked on the earth, the Bible makes it clear that everything he said and did was a revelation of who God is. So when God wanted to reveal himself to man, who he is, what he is like, of course, in times previous to that, he spoke through his prophets, and each prophet brought a piece of revelation and said, God is like this. God is Jehovah Jireh. God is Jehovah Rapha. And some aspect of God, God was revealing continuously through his servants, the prophets. But now, when Jesus came and he walked on the earth in bodily form, he was God, Emmanuel, with us. And everything he said and he did was an expression of who God is. And what I want to do today is just to focus on something that we see in the Gospels, in the four Gospels that record the earthly life of Jesus for us, something very interesting. We notice that every time that Jesus was moved with compassion and he touched people, and whenever he touched somebody, something happened in their lives. Just one touch, and something happened. We also notice in the Gospels that sometimes people came to Jesus in faith and touched him, and just one touch in faith changed something in their lives. And that's what I want to focus on. You know, some of you who are watching this service, you may be sitting at home, and there's an area in your life where you want the Lord Jesus to touch you. Maybe it's physical. Maybe it's emotional. Maybe it's a situation in your life. And I want to encourage you that as you listen to the sermon today, your faith will be ignited. Your faith will be encouraged, so that at the end of the service, when we pray, my heart's desire is that you will experience the touch of Jesus in your point of need, in your area of need, whether it's physical, it's emotional, or any other miracle. And as we go through the various people that Jesus touched and what happened to them, I want to tell you something, that Jesus Christ is the same yesterday, today, and forever. And I believe in my heart that Jesus is the same to you today, right where you are, in your living room or wherever you're watching, that he will be the same to you as he was to these people that we talk about 2,000 years ago. Now, maybe you're sitting in your room and you're saying, you know, everything is fine. I'm glad Jesus already touched my life and he's, you know, fix me all up very fine, and I'm doing good. But maybe you know somebody, a relative, a close friend, who needs a touch. And as you're listening to this sermon, and as faith is being stirred up in your heart, I want you to bear that person's name before God and say, Lord, I know this person. This person is close to me. Maybe a family member, or maybe a very dear friend. And you bear their name throughout this sermon and say, Jesus, everything I'm hearing about you doing for other people, I want you to do it for so-and-so today. And at the end of this program, end of the service, when we pray together, I want you to bear their name so that they will experience the touch of Jesus wherever they are. They may not be with you right now. They may be in some other city or maybe in some other part of the world. But as you bear their name, let's believe God that one touch from Jesus will change everything in their lives. And I want you to stay in faith, and also make sure that as you're experiencing something on the live chat, just say what the Lord Jesus is doing for you. You know, it'll be great for us to receive your testimonies as and when it's happening. So make sure when the Lord Jesus Christ touches you throughout this sermon or at the end when we pray, make sure you write your testimony on the live chat. You know, I was healed from this and this, or this and this happened to me right now as I was listening to the message or as we were praying. It'd be great to receive your testimonies while we're going through this. So Jesus, we see that, you know, in his earthly ministry, The Lord Jesus was moved with compassion and he touched people. And I want to just make a little journey through the Gospels and just observe Jesus as he walked on the earth and how he interacted with people and just one touch and what happened to the people. In Mark chapter 1, we read this about a leper who came to Jesus. You know, you can imagine his condition, his body ravaged by leprosy, an outcast. Nobody wants to come near him. Nobody would even want to care about him. But here somehow, you know, he sees all this big crowd around Jesus, and Jesus finished the Sermon on the Mount, and he's coming down the hillside, and somehow this leper gets to close enough to Jesus to say this to Jesus. He says, "Lord, if you are willing, you can make me clean." And this is what happens in Mark chapter 1, verse 41. The Bible says, Jesus moved with compassion, stretched out his hand and touched him and said to him, "I am willing, be cleansed." And the Bible says he was cleansed immediately. Now think about Jesus. He touched somebody that nobody else would have dared to even go nearby. Everybody would want to stay away from this person, but something in Jesus, it says he was moved with compassion. He loved this man and he touched him, and that one touch made this man clean. Jesus is the same yesterday, today, and forever. And as you're watching this in your living room or wherever you're watching from, Jesus is moved with compassion for you. Nobody may want to come near you. Maybe doctors have taken their hands off of you. Maybe your caregivers are saying, "Look, this is beyond hope." But I want to let you know, Jesus Christ is there with you. And just as he was moved with compassion, he's moved with for the leper. He's moved with compassion for you, and he will touch you. And that one touch will make all the difference. In Matthew chapter 8, you know, Jesus met with the centurion, and then he's on his way, and he comes to Peter's house in Capernaum. And as he enters Peter's house, he finds out that Peter's wife's mother, Peter's mother-in-law, was sick of a fever. And she's laid down there. And the Bible tells us here in Matthew 8, verse 15, he touched her hand and the fever left her and she arose and served them. Matthew 8, 15, he touched her hand and the fever left. You know, whatever sickness and disease is in your body, it may be something small, it may be something serious, but one touch from Jesus, he touched her hand and the fever left. He touched her and her disease left. He touches you and your disease leaves. And that's what will happen today because we believe in that same Jesus. You know, there were two blind men in Matthew chapter 9. Verses 29 and 30, they heard about Jesus, and I'm assuming somebody was helping them move around, and they said, "Hey, Jesus is passing by, shout, Jesus is passing by." And so here were these two blind men, and they began to cry out. The Bible says, "Son of David, have mercy on us." Or if you want to put it in simple English, they were crying out saying, "Son of David, have compassion on us. Oh, do something good for us. Extend your goodness to us." And Jesus stopped, and he said, "Do you believe that I'm able to do this?" And they said, "Yes, Lord." And here's what the Bible records in Matthew 9:29. It says, he touched their eyes, saying, "According to your faith, let it be to you." And their eyes were opened. It says he touched their eyes and said, "According to your faith, let it be done for you." So there Jesus touched them, but he was touching them, connecting with them at their point of faith. And that's what I want to encourage in our hearts today. As we have faith in the Lord Jesus, and he, in his mercy and his compassion, touches us, that's the connection point. When our faith connects with his compassion, something happens. He touched them. He said, "According to your faith, let it be done to you." I want to encourage your faith. As we recount these stories, let faith arise in your heart. And I want you to be fully convinced that what Jesus Christ did for them, he will do for you. Because the Bible says that God is no respecter of persons. He doesn't have favorites. He doesn't just do something for some people and says, you know, I won't do it for the others. No, he is no respecter of persons. But everywhere when people reach out to him in faith, he will respond the same way to each and every person. You know, in Matthew 17, on the Mount of Transfiguration, we have Peter, James, and John. They're up there on the mount, they have just had a powerful encounter with God, and it must have been so scary. It must have really, scared them. The Bible tells us they were so afraid when they encountered the very presence of God. God's presence came like a bright cloud, and there was a sound from heaven saying, "This is my beloved Son," and they were completely scared. But in that moment, here's what Jesus does. In Matthew 17, verses 6 and 7, it says, "When the disciples heard it, they fell on their faces and were greatly afraid. But Jesus came and touched them and said, 'Arise, do not be afraid.'" You can imagine this. Just try to imagine this. One touch from Jesus, it calmed their fears. It just changed the whole moment for them. You know, perhaps they thought, that's it. We are dead. We are not going to leave this place alive. We've come too close to God, or something like that. But Jesus touches them, and their fears leave. And I believe today, right where you are in your home, if there are things that have been troubling your mind, fears, whatever it is, one touch from Jesus can bring a great calm, can bring a great peace into your life. There were two men sitting outside of Jericho in Matthew 20, verse 34. It talks about, Jesus coming down this Jericho road, and here were these two men. And they heard the sound of a crowd passing by, and somebody tells them, "Hey, it's Jesus of Nazareth. He's passing by. The healer is passing by. The one who's making blind eyes open is passing by." And so these two blind men cry out saying, "Son of David, have mercy on us." Now the people tell them to keep quiet. The people say, "Don't make all this noise. Be calm, be quiet." But Jesus stops. He calls these two men to come to him. He asks them, "What do you want me to do for you?" And they said, "Lord, we want to receive our sight." Now you can just imagine, if you put yourself in the place of these two blind men, this was the moment of a lifetime. Perhaps their entire life, they were hoping somebody would do something to give them their sight back or to give them their eyesight. And here was their moment. Jesus was right there. The one who could open their blind eyes was right there. And even though the crowd tried to, suppress them, they cried out. And when Jesus asked them, "What do you want me to do for you?" They said, "Lord, we want to receive our sight." And here's what Jesus does. In Matthew 20, verse 34, it says, once again, Jesus had compassion and touched their eyes. And immediately their eyes received sight and they followed him. Jesus was moved with compassion and he touched their eyes, and immediately their eyes received sight. And I want to assure you this morning that Jesus Christ is the same. He's once again, he is moved with compassion towards you. Perhaps there is a situation in your life that you've been waiting for a long time to have changed, to have, a turn around, and today as we pray, I believe that Jesus Christ will be moved with compassion for you and will touch you in that area of your life. For these two blind men, it had to do with their eyesight. Maybe in your life, it's another situation, another circumstance. It could be healing, it could be deliverance in your mind, your emotions, or it could be some other area that you've been waiting to have change. You're waiting to see an intervention. Today is your day. Today, as we pray together, we will believe Jesus, that he will have compassion on you and he will touch you and everything will change. We have so many examples. There was a deaf man in Mark 7, verses 33 and 35. Here was a deaf man. He couldn't hear, and he had an impediment in his speech, and they brought him to Jesus. And Jesus does the same thing. He puts his fingers in his ears, he touches, and he puts spit, and he touches his tongue, and immediately his ears were open and his tongue was loosed and he began to speak. And we read about many other instances where Jesus touched people and things happened. There were little children whom they brought to Jesus, and Jesus laid his hands on them. He touched them and he blessed them. When he comes into the city of Nain in Luke, the 7th chapter, as he's getting into the city, there's a funeral procession going by. A lady who was a widow has just lost her only son, and Jesus touches that casket, and this young man is brought back to life. One touch changed her entire life. You know, what is interesting is in Luke 22, just before Jesus was apprehended by the Roman soldiers, when they came to apprehend him, one of the disciples, Jesus, cut off a soldier's ear. And at that moment, when Jesus himself is being, you know, was about to be apprehended and taken to be crucified, he touches this ear of the soldier and heals it. You know, it tells us so much about the compassion and the goodness of Jesus. You know, when Jesus touched people, things changed in their lives. But we also see, as I mentioned, the other side, when people came to Jesus and touched Jesus. And I want to just bring our attention to a few instances in the Gospels when people came to Jesus and they touched him. I want to talk about that because I want to encourage you that by your faith, you reach out and you touch Jesus today. And when you make that connect by faith, things will happen. So here's a very well-known incident in the Gospels. It's this woman with the issue of blood. You know, she had this problem for 12 years. And for 12 years, she was reaching out for help to the point where the Bible says she had spent all her money on doctors trying to recover. You know, that shows her desire to be well. She desired to get better. And of course, she had the means to do it. And she was making every effort to try to get help to be relieved of her condition. And then she hears about Jesus. She makes her way to the crowd. And this was her faith. She said, "If I will touch his clothes, the edge of his garment, I will be made well." And so we read about this in Matthew chapter 9, verses 20 and 21. It says, "A woman who had a flow of blood for 12 years came from behind and touched the hem of his garment. For she said to herself, 'If only I may touch the garment, I shall be made well.' Jesus turned around. When he saw her, he said, 'Be of good cheer, daughter. Your faith has made you well.'" Her faith, her touch, and she was made well. And I want to encourage our hearts today that you and I can do the same thing. Let me just make a mention of a few more instances and then we're going to pray. In Matthew chapter 14, verses 35 and 36, it tells us about great crowds of people. It says, "When the men of that place recognized him, they sent out into all the surrounding region, brought to him all who were sick, and begged him that they might only touch the hem of his garment, and as many as touched it were made perfectly well." People were coming and saying, "Jesus, all we want to do is want to just touch you." I mean, just try to imagine that scene. Jesus is walking. There are crowds of sick people, and they're all having one request. "Jesus, we just want to touch you." Now, what if you were in that crowd? What would you have done? Would you have stood there and said, maybe it's for them, not for me? Or would you have stood there and said, you know, theologically, reason yourself out of this? No, I'm sure that if you were in the crowd, you'd have done what the crowd was doing. You'd have gone with that same faith and you would have said, "If I will only touch the hem of his garment, I will be healed." And that's what the crowd was doing. They only wanted to touch him. And it says here, "As many as touched it were made perfectly well." The same thing is true today. As many, or everyone who touches Jesus, will be made well. Everything will be made all right in their lives. And I want you to know that it can happen to you today, that as you touch him. In Mark 3 verse 10, it says, "He healed so many, so that as many as had afflictions pressed about him to touch him." People were pressing in to touch him. And I want to encourage you press in to touch him today. Your faith will connect with him and you will be able to receive. In Luke 6 and verse 19, it says that great multitudes, a whole multitude sought to touch him. For power went out from him and healed them all. They all sought to touch him, because the power of God was going out of him and healing multitudes. You know, the Bible tells us that when people touched Jesus, they received a change, a miracle in their lives. The beautiful thing is this, that Jesus even allowed sinners to touch him. You know, even sinners can touch Jesus in faith. You know, you might be saying, well, you don't know the kind of life I've lived. You know, I really messed up. I did things I should not have done, or maybe I was not responsible. I failed to do what I should have done. You know, all of us, you know, I have messed up in various areas of our lives. We're not perfect. And so sometimes that holds us back. We think we are not worthy. You know, I'm not as good as so-and-so. I mean, that person reads his Bible and prays, and maybe that person can reach out in faith and touch. And you might not think yourself as worthy, but I want to help you. You know, in the Bible talks about in Luke chapter 7, a woman, you know, Jesus had gone to the house of a person. They were sitting for a meal. And here comes this woman who makes her entrance into this house uninvited. And just because she hears that Jesus is in that house, and she comes there and she begins to, you know, cry at the feet of Jesus, weep at his feet. And she's wiping his feet with her hair. And here's the response. It says in Luke 7:39, it says, when the Pharisees who had invited him saw this, he spoke to himself, saying, this man, if he were a prophet, would know who and what manner of woman this is who is touching him, for she is a sinner. You know, the person who invited Jesus, he was a Pharisee, a religious person, and he was saying, you know, if Jesus was a prophet, he would have known that this woman who was touching him was a very, very sinful woman. She did not have a good name. She did not have a good life. People knew her. But Jesus was allowing this woman to touch him. You know, and at the end of it, I'm just getting to the last verse there. It says, Jesus said to this woman, your faith has saved you. Go in peace. Jesus allowed the sinner to touch him. And then he told this woman, your faith has saved you. Your faith has changed your life. Your faith has done something in you that none of these religious people could do for you. Your faith has changed you. Go in peace. And I want to encourage you. It doesn't matter what kind of a life you've lived. Today, as we bring this message to you, as Jesus Christ is waiting and is full of compassion, your faith can bring healing into your life. Your faith can cause something to change. Jesus allows sinners to reach out to him in faith. And a miracle can takes place when his goodness and our faith connect. This moment is a very important moment. We are getting ready to pray. And I want to encourage you, when his goodness connects with our faith, a miracle takes place. God is good to all. He's good to you. His goodness extends to you. And you and I just have to reach out in faith. You know, you can touch Jesus and you can receive his touch. Jesus is ready to touch you, and you can touch him with your faith. You know, just one touch will change everything. I want to assure you that one touch from Jesus will change everything in your life, whether it's healing, whether it's emotional healing, whether it's a miracle that you need in your life situation. One touch from Jesus will change everything. And that's what this service is about. That one touch that you need to heal, that one touch that you need to break the yoke of sickness off of you, that one touch that you need to work a miracle in your life situation. That's what we want to see happen for you as we pray. Now, I want to just highlight what you and I must do. You know, this woman with the issue of blood, The four things we see in her life. First of all, she heard about Jesus. You know, faith came into her heart when she heard about Jesus. People told her about Jesus. And on this service today, we have mentioned to you about the many things Jesus did while he ministered to people. And that would have built faith in your heart, because faith comes by hearing the word of God. So we encourage you, as you've heard, you know, faith is ripe in your heart. Faith has risen in your heart because his word produces faith. Now, this woman heard the word, then she believed. She said, yes, Jesus is my healer. Jesus can do this for me. If he's done it for others, he can do it for me. And right where you are, I wanted you to know that if you will believe, he will do it for you. Then she said, the third thing she did, she said, if I will touch him, I will be healed. If I will touch him, I will be healed. If I will touch the hem of his garment, I will be healed. She announced her faith. She declared her faith. And I want you to do the same thing. As we begin to pray, you say, Jesus, I know if I touch you, I will be healed. I know one touch from you will change my life. I want you to say that. And Lord, I'm expecting your touch right now. And the fourth thing is this. She acted her faith. She went out through the crowd and she touched the edge of his garment. And today, when we get ready to pray, I want to encourage you to act your faith. I want you to do something that will show Jesus that you believe that he will heal you. And I'm going to give some instructions as we get ready to pray. Now, to help us prepare for our time of prayer and ministry, our worship team is going to sing for us that wonderful old chorus, He Touched Me. Now, I want you to sing it with the worship team. I want you to make that song your song as you expect the Lord Jesus to touch you. Don't just let them sing it. You sing it with them. Make it your declaration. Just like the woman who said it, you sing it that He touched you, that he will touch you. Or maybe you're bearing somebody else's name before the Lord as the worship team sings that song in your mind, in your heart. You say, Jesus, touch this person. Touch their life. You know, it may be healing. Maybe they need to be set free from problems. Maybe they need to be set free from other bondages. As the worship team sings this song, I want you to bear their name and say, Jesus, touch them. Let this be a moment for you through that song that you will release your faith, whether it's for yourself or whether it's for somebody else. And once the worship team is done with the song, I will come back. We are going to pray together. And that's the moment I want you to act your faith. I want you to believe that at that moment, Jesus Christ will touch your heart, your life, whatever that you need, whatever is in your body will be healed and your mind will be set free, that miracles will happen. I will be right back after we worship together with our worship team.
Touch me and now. he touched me and made